right? Another one on the right, thank you. So I have a really cool class in store for everybody today. I hope everybody's having a good day so far. I know we got everything extended till May 15th, but hopefully this thing's coming to an end. Hopefully everything can be opened up in May sometime, you know, middle of May, end of May. Now, cool stuff, I got a bunch of cool combinations, tactics, drills, but mostly moves that both boxing and kickboxing champions use. If there's a specific Jeet Kune Do tactic in there, which a lot of them will have a Jeet Kune Do tactic in there, and I'll explain it through and through. I'll talk about the champion, I'll talk about the move itself, and I'll talk about its relationship to Jeet Kune Do. So in three pieces. So the champion, the move itself, and its relationship to Jeet Kune Do as we're going through today. So yesterday we did MMA guys. Today we're gonna do specialists, strikers, and kickboxers. And I promise when social distancing isn't a thing anymore, we're gonna do more wrestling, more grappling, submission and grappling, like jujitsu stuff, but really some wrestling too. So let's get right into it. Let me just get my boxing gloves on right, so I'm gonna play hit the bag a little bit with you guys. So remember those three stances, your southpaw, conventional, open or no stance. Sometimes we're gonna start with the boxing stuff, then we're gonna do the kickboxing stuff later. I really do believe that you should spend the time to really focus on your hands first. Legs, same time, but kind of second, but you know, same time-ish. And then putting it together third. Today we're gonna start with the hands, then we're gonna just put it together with the legs. We're gonna kind of skip a little step just for time. But, you know, whenever you're in there, when you're further, your arms can be a little bit more extended, especially the lead hand. It's there to distance find, to probe. It doesn't do you, think about it at range, it doesn't do you as much good tucking in, unless you're really worried about the guy leaping in with a big bomb that you're not gonna see, right? But lead hand is extended. Bang, 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 bang. So, first and foremost, I've mentioned them before on the channel and before in class, main guy first we're going to talk about is Vasily Lomachenko. If you look at, he's in this position. When him and his opponent are at a longer range. And he's out there and... just walking around just jabbing. Like he's there, he's on his ankles, and he's shooting these vicious hooks, these vicious jabs. By the way, he's following the Jeet Kune Do. So, fighter, the move itself, we're talking about the stance and the way he's using his lead hand for now. We're going to talk about some other stuff in this, though. And then the Jeet Kune Do principle, he is a southpaw. He is a right foot forward, but right hand dominant southpaw. So he's like a Jeet Kune Do southpaw. He's a guy who chose to lead with his stronger side. And there's a lot of advantages for that, including you throw a greater volume and a greater variety of punches with your lead hand. Your backhand will still have power. He sits there and he'll just clean guys' clock. Just double up the left hand. Just tripling, quadrupling up the left hand on guys, getting their guards up. Be like, ha, 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 and just coming over the top. Just, he's literally, in my opinion, the most complete fighter I've ever seen live. So please, 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 do yourself a favor. Check out Vasily Lomachenko. He's a boxing champion. Smaller guy, like in the 140s. Super awesome. Now, he does something so awesome. And a lot of the students in the school are doing this, and they're doing it live in sparring, which I think is so cool. They're there when they slip, the feet slide. So like, in Jeet Kune Do, you learn this motion, but when your one foot steps aside, you become more of an open stance. Because this happens sometimes in fighting, like you're in this closed, bladed position, then one foot steps out, and you're able to slide an angle, right? So if my one foot steps, I'm able to slide an angle. So we were teaching it for like the last like 2 years, and then I see a lot of the students pulling it off, which I think is really cool, right? That's what a teacher wants out of the students. See the moves that you're teaching being pulled off live. So again, you know, I'm here, I'm firing, I'm firing, I'm firing, head comes off live, and just hard shots down the middle. So same thing the other way, huh? Hard shots coming down the middle. So once you take that angle, those hard shots just come right down the middle. So it's like, if you look at my legs, my feet, the second I'm firing, my head goes this way, bang, right down the middle. So my head and my foot go in the same direction at the same time. Other way, the head and the foot go in the same direction at the same time. So same fighter, Vasyl Lomachenko, the tactic, head movement with the footwork, but specifically head movement with a slide into big power shots off of the angle, right? Another cool thing that Vasyl does is hand trapping. Guys got his hands up to guard here. He'll literally pull the top of the glove down. So he'll pull the glove on the far side. So his left will touch the other guy's left. And just hit him with the hook, which is cool. So he's there, pop, 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 pop. Fires it like across, pulls it down, pop, and just smashing shots down the middle. So super, super cool. Vasyl Lomachenko, probably my favorite fighter right now. Again, I plug this guy all the time because I'll tell you a fun story. I was actually in Vegas when Mayweather was fighting Pacquiao, and we saw Lomachenko fighting in like the undercard, and I was like, wow, that guy moves like a JKD guy, he's awesome. But with all the hype of the biggest fight ever probably in our time, kind of forgot about him. But then he came back and he just started smashing people, and just the footwork, and just there, you could have a whole just tutorial on that guy, and we probably should, but I'm going to give you different champions today. So Vasyl Lomachenko, that's one champion. Man, like, awesome guy. Another southpaw, another one of my favorite fighters, I just mentioned them, Manny Pacquiao. And I'm going to show you, so Manny Pacquiao is a fighter. The rear straight is the tool. He fires his left hand like a rear straight, which means he pushes out. The fight you should check out to look at that is Manny Pacquiao versus Oscar De La Hoya. He split his jab, basically. So we're here, I'm fighting. You're with your left foot forward, I have my right foot forward, you fire your jab, pop, you know, I just dart out. So you fire, pop, I just dart out. And I'm going to show it to you on the bag, but man, he beat up De La Hoya with this tool. And it was such a cool case study of how the rear hand can intercept, which is the Jeet principle we're going to talk about in this one. The rear hand can intercept the jab when the jab is overcommitted a bit, right? So Pacquiao just stood there nice and relaxed, basically, bang, and just literally just launched that thing. Like, so he just was hanging out, bang, looking, just literally just not sitting on it super hard, not planting his feet. Like, sometimes you fire across, you sit on it, and you really put a lot of mustard on that thing. But Pacquiao was timing De La Hoya's jab, so De La Hoya kind of like, he had like a weird, almost like marching rhythm in that fight. And Pacquiao's not the type of guy who just walked down. He's too good. So he just, De La Hoya just walked up to him, perfect boxing position, trying to jab and double jab and just do the stuff you learn on day one. Pacquiao just hung out. He's like that. And what was cool is, I'll show you the exit that Pacquiao used on this fight too, and you can check it out in the tape. So Pacquiao was here, right? He shot that rear straight. Watch this. He slid, shuffled his feet, turned the corner. So beautiful. So simple and so beautiful. Please, please, please watch that fight. So the jab came. He shot the cross, scored. Look at my feet now. Shuffled, turned the corner. Wow. So, so, so beautiful. Now, Pacquiao. See, you got to be careful with this tactic too, because you can't lunge in all the time. Sometimes you got to step with the jab, sometimes you push. That's like something we don't talk about a lot. Some people prefer to step, pop, pop, Some people prefer to push. And you gotta be careful when you push that your head doesn't go forward too much. See, when you step, it's easy. When you push, some people's head dips. So watch. Head over my pelvis.
Bang, bang,
bang. Kill me. I'm in front of the guy and I'm firing, right? So, okay, Manny Pacquiao. His ability to just do what's called a rocker shuffle or a modified rocker shuffle. So he's there, he's bouncing. Just fast 1-2 comes down the pipe. So all I did there was I'm bouncing, fast 1-2 comes down the pipe. And when you do this and you throw 2-3 shots, it works. When you do this and you fire one shot, or one shot, or one shot, is a lot of times when you get in trouble. So my suggestion, if you're gonna lunge in on somebody, throw 3-4-2, and make the first 2-3 shots fast. So he's bouncing, breathing, looking at the guy, moving. And Pacquiao also has really good side-to-side head movement. Like, he'll be there, you'll back him up a little bit, even if it's for a couple of, his head's like this. And what's interesting is if my head, think about it slow, if my head is on this side, when it goes this way, that cross is super hard. That cross is super hard, right? So think about it. If my head is on this side, that cross is nasty. So when I'm here and my head is here, it's just right down the middle, right? If you were this way, head's here, right down the middle, right? Same thing with your hook. So what's Pacquiao doing with his head movement? He's such an aggressive fighter. He's being defensively responsible, but man, he's loading his shots for power. So then you're here, head's on this side, full blown hook, right? Full power, full blown hook. So Pacquiao is an aggressive boxer puncher. What's up, Tom? Question. Pacquiao is an aggressive boxer puncher with speed, power, durability, endurance, and just overall toughness. I mean, reason the guy's been a multiple time, you know, world champion. So Pacquiao's ability to lunge in and out, covering distance, big and jeep, you know, so the fighters, Pacquiao, rear straight was his first tool. Being able to lunge in on just basic shots, 1-2s, hook threes, you know, hook twos, things like that. And also Pacquiao's ability to just simply shift his weight in small space, right? So again, like, he's here, he just simply, like, shifts and fires, shifts and fires. He's just shifting and firing and just using that weight transfer to really put and lay damage on people. I always thought that Manny Pacquiao was a great fighter. Now, I gave you some Jeet Kune Do guys. I'll give you a guy that, look, he's arguably the best boxer of my living lifetime, like me watching boxing, 31 years old. Mayweather, you know, he does a lot of cool things. Does a lot of cool things. I'm gonna go through some basic stuff, but I'm actually gonna start with one that's super fancy that he does. So, there's 5 ways to attack somebody in Jeet Kune Do. So, they stole some of this from fencing and certain things. It's really cool. So you have a single direct attack. Think about just one punch, one kick, one takedown, right? A single direct attack. You have to be so much more dominant than somebody who just hit them with one shot and just finish, right? Attack by combination, double, jab, cross, hook, roll, bang, bang, right? Multiple shots. Attack by hand immobilization attack. So hand immobilization. You're fighting, your hands are up, and I get my hands on you, start pulling, bang, 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 right? Then I start attacking you. I start tying up your hands. The third is hand immobilization attack. Fourth is progressive indirect attack. I feint low, come over the top, which we're gonna go over in a few, right? So I take distance on a fake, I draw your attention down, bash you over the top. So progressive indirect attack. Mayweather uses the fifth one, which is attack by drawing. So it's called attack by drawing. I give you a line. We're fighting, the line is open. You know it. I definitely know it. The question is, do you know that I did it on purpose or not? But a lot of times the guy may even, he literally pokes his face out, shot comes, he pulls back, hits a perfect right hand. Now he's in perfect boxing position now. Pop, rolls under. It's so beautiful. It's one of the most beautiful baits. So there's certain things, there's different terminology in different combat sports. So in Jeet Kune Do, you would say, you know, I trapped him, like I'm not trapped like trapping here, it's like I set a trap for him, right? In boxing they call it baiting and trapping, right? So we call it traps, they call it baiting and trapping, same little difference, right? So I'm here, and then I'm there, I'm in front of the guy, now I lean my way forward, and I go for it. So I pull back, pop, 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 and it's just a good exercise to do, like, when you fire a cross, pull, pull, pull. So sometimes it's just your head, I like the head of the foot, even if it's just a little bit. So you're in front of the guy right here, and then when you land it, try to get your glove up to be in perfect boxing position for the cross.
So Ramon is asking
the
shift you were talking about, mentioning Pacquiao, is that shift stationary or?
He does it stationary. So the way Pacquiao does it is, Pacquiao's usually in motion on his feet and he's firing, but then so you gotta understand, everybody, all of you, myself included, there's times when you're in there where your feet are pretty much stationary, right? So one of three things should be happening. Your feet should be in motion, your head should be in motion, or you should be attacking in one way, shape, or another, right? When you're doing two of those three, let's say my feet are in motion and I'm attacking. My feet are in motion, my head is in motion, and I'm sharking and attacking, and that's really good too. I'm being defensively responsible with my hands and my feet and my parries and pulling my legs and doing all that stuff, right? And so, yeah, it's the more you do, the better. What Pacquiao likes to do is when his feet are stationary, he's just loading. And then when he sees a shot, you know, if like, again, his weight's here, he's launching off that back foot. Right there, and it's nasty because I mean he busts guys up like Manny Pacquiao. You guys have to watch these guys. Like if you're serious about martial arts, and you're serious about, if you just like combat sports, if you like boxing, kickboxing, MMA, whatever, you just have to watch these guys because they give you so much insight because they're doing it live against other good guys that are top tier champions. So much for Manny Pacquiao. He's awesome. And by the way, he does a clear as day Jeet Kune Do technique. He throws a vertical fist jab. You can see it on the Modern Martial Arts channel. It's a good channel that studies a lot of champion fighters too. It's pretty cool. He does like a fight breakdowns on each fighter. So the Modern Martial Arts, you guys can check that out too. But they show it. He's there and he just goes bang. And he actually steps his foot. See, in Jeet Kune Do, the lead foot does funny things. Like sometimes you step it straight, like on the first rail, and sometimes you step it inwards. Pacquiao does that, like he'll be out here, and he'll fire like a vertical fist jab, but he's going this way. And it's really cool, because his right foot's going forward, and then his left foot kind of takes the angle on it, and it's super slippery. And it's just, look where you are. It's like you start here, and you're just angling that way, whether it's a jab or a straight lead. He throws it as a straight lead, a vertical fist, which is really cool. And he's here. Just, man, the guy is just, there is no doubt he's one of the best. And he loves Bruce Lee. If you listen to Manny Pacquiao talk about Bruce Lee, praises Bruce Lee up and down, just like a lot of the UFC champions did, like Anderson Silva. There's a lot of them. George St. Pierre loves him too. A lot of the Gracies, like Hicks and Gracies, are going to be the best. Any popular, John Jones wearing a Jeet Kune Do shirt, throwing G-Tex. Conor McGregor trains out of the Street Blast Gym, which is a Jeet Kune Do term. Really cool. Really cool stuff. So we're talking about Mayweather. So we went through Manny Pacquiao. We went through Lomachenko first, we went through Manny Pacquiao. Now we're on Mayweather and his pull action, right? Another thing that Mayweather does that a lot of Jeet Kune Do guys do is the Philly shove. The Philly shove looks like this is good when you're in the same lead. My hand is in this low L position. My feet are turned in a little bit more. My chin is down. This hand, so watch. This hand can catch your, so my right hand's forward. Catch your right hand if you're a southpaw too. Parry, catch downward. You could also cover. I could dip this way. I could slip this way. I could simply dip down. Catch down the middle too. This shoulder rolls the cross. Rolls the cross and I fire my arm up. Do you have a question? Now, what's cool is this hand now, the jab comes up. And it can bounce into your chest and into your body with ease, right? So what Mayweather does, like the best of them, is that shoulder roll. He'll be there, and he's using conventional, so I'll do it the way he does it. He's here, he'll catch the jab, shoulder rolls across, fire a pin straight cross down the middle, he rolls under, and he fires the rest of his combination. So he'll be there, he'll be nice and relaxed, sometimes he lets the guy like back him up a little bit, shoulders high, catches, rolls, fires, dips under, and then he's back to business, right? Mayweather is one of the best of all time, if not the best of all time, just super good. I mean, if him and Loma were neck and neck, they'd have to fight. Mayweather's a lot bigger, and he's a lot older now, obviously, he's retired and everything. So, like, two kind of like. And, I mean, he's got 50 fights. You know, Loma's got a long way to get all those fights, but really cool. So, Mayweather does a lot of cool stuff like that. Another cool thing that Mayweather does is he catches and shoots. So they'll be there and they'll catch and shoot over your shot. So like imagine I'm here, I'm southpaw, right? You fire across and you fire from a little bit too long. I catch and I shoot my own jab down the middle. Pop, 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 that's cool. Pop, pop over the top of your cross. Pop, pop. This hand's high for your hook. Pop, pop, pop. So you're there, right from this position, just right down the middle and just smashing, right? So all these tactics are super high level, obviously. Super, super high level tactics and very, very awesome. To go back to that little head pull that Mayweather does too, he does it with the back foot moving, the way we do it. Snap away stuff. In boxing, they call that a pull, and Jeet Kune Do call that a snap away. Snap away, fire. Snap away, fire. Right with the foot. Foot moves back, right? Philly shell is his other tactic. Attack by drawing with the pull or the snap away was tactic one. Philly shell is tactic two. Now, a lot of cool stuff that Mayweather does. Simple things with his footwork. He'll bob and weave, so like he'll be here, he'll duck, and he'll slide out of the way. If you notice in footwork, some of the best and slipperiest footwork guys use the slide. This way, that way, this way. Because think about it, is stepping faster or is shuffling and sliding faster? When I want to be elusive and a slippery target, I want to pick a fast motion that I don't have to be super explosive with. I can slide all over the floor. I'm slipping, I'm sliding, and just my feet are just not on the floor for more than 1 or 2 seconds, right? So, sorry, I was out of frame. So my feet are not on the floor for more than 1 or 2 seconds. I'm just slipping and sliding, just being a pest and being elusive. So what Mayweather does is like, go back to that simple combo. Catch, roll, cross, slides, pop, 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 and he's back to business, right? He rolls this way. Slide. So whenever he's lateral, he's sliding. He's sliding. Sometimes the guy backs him up. He's just bounce up. And then he slides. And he's using a little bit of athleticism, but what he's really using is good technique and footwork to get himself out of danger. Remember. So now the tactics that we're talking about is footwork. And footwork not overall, but the slide stuff. and the slide step's ability to get you out of danger. So that's Mayweather, the champion, the tactic is the slide step, using it to get out of danger when he feels himself on the ropes. So he's there, he's moving, and he's sliding. And he's just, boom, he's just darting. It's hard to catch up to somebody that doesn't want to be caught. Especially towards the end of the fight, especially like if they're not exhausted or you're not exhausted in this case. So again, Mayweather is another boxing champion that you just have to watch. You have to watch him. So another boxing champion, Canelo Alvarez, we're gonna talk about two very nasty tactics that he does. First one is gonna be a little progressive indirect attack. So that was one of our five ways of attack. So the champion is Canelo Alvarez. The technique is gonna be progressive indirect attack. I'm gonna show you the actual combo. And the Jeet Kune Do principle is progressive indirect attack. This is a big part of Jeet Kune Do. So progressive indirect attack is when I show you one line to clip you with another, right? So he did this against, I forgot the guy's name, but he knocked him out cold with the right hand. The guy was long and lanky, very, very good British boxer. I'm gonna get you the guy's the name the next time, but Canelo Alvarez, big, 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 huge knockout. All he did was this. He was here, he fainted low, and the big overhand came over the top. It was so beautiful. Guy got hit on the tip of the chin, whoop, went down.
Mayweather
beat up Canelo Alvarez. Canelo Alvarez, Amir Khan, that's what it was. If you look up Canelo Alvarez versus Amir Khan, you're gonna see this. So nasty. So nasty. So he goes low, overhand, this way, overhand, overhand. Now, that's tactic number one, progressive indirect attack, feinting the low jab, coming over with the overhand, feinting the low jab, clipping over the top of the overhead. Now, I think, me personally, and a lot of fighters use this tool, one of the most vicious body shots in all of fighting is the left leg to the body, hits the liver. If your right lead, it comes off the backhand. If your left lead, it comes off the lead hand, and you need to slip normally, right? But sometimes, bang, like, sometimes I'll be in there and I'll just see it, and I won't even load for it, I'll just shoot it with my head on this side, bang, and then I come back upstairs. But what Canelo does is just classic, you learn it day one, classic Mexican style, but also American style boxing, is you slip and rip. Slip and rip. Slip and rip. So he's in front of the guy, heads on center, heads off center, and rips. Rips. Sometimes he gets his feet into it. Right, and he starts here. Ah, and he just rips into guys. So off of that, there's a lot of really nasty stuff you could do on right knee too, and then the other side up on center, off center, off, off, off center, right? So these body shots are vicious, and what boxers are really good at is obviously attacking the body and hitting guys in ways that most people don't understand. Is there a question?
Yeah. So Marcelo is asking, if you recommend looking at older fighters like Prince or Sugar
Prince
Ray,
Nassim?
Or yeah.
Who? Prince Nassim and who else?
Yeah, Sugar Ray.
First of all, as an overall, I'm gonna sit down and talk to you guys for a second. So, first of all, as an overall rule of thumb, looking at old fighters like the greats, like Muhammad Ali, George Foreman, even. Holyfield, Tyson, is like some of the heavyweight guys, but even like some of the recent champions like Floyd Mayweather, go back more, Sugar Ray Robinson, absolutely, Jack Dempsey, absolutely, Sugar Ray Leonard, absolutely, Muhammad Ali, absolutely, Joe Frazier, absolutely, like, I mean, how many, I can just go, Bernard Hopkins, absolutely, Roy Jones, absolutely, like, watch the old champions. I mean, you're not gonna lose anything from watching them. Even MMA watching the old champions, but for boxing, for sure, boxing's been around so long. Kickboxing too, which is what we're gonna get into next. I'm just taking a little break, because it's hit the bag. So, when you look at kickboxing, We're going to look at a guy named Buakaw, who's like a big Muay Thai guy, but he uses some pretty cool tactics. We're definitely going to look at him. There's, man, I forgot the guy's name, but he does a pendulum hook kick. We've already done the pendulum hook kick. He was a K-1 champion that was doing the pendulum hook kick. That's well and fine. Now, I'm going to name a Sanda champion, Kong Lee. We're going to do the sidekick probably, which is pretty cool. We're going to do some kickboxing stuff and some kickboxing combinations that a lot of the champions were using, like whether it's K-1, Glory, or guys that transitioned into MMA that were just big time kickboxers. So the only difference in kickboxing is instead of just the hands, you can use the knees and the shins. Some kickboxing styles are going to do some of the clinch, some don't. We're going to start with long range combinations. We may do a little bit of the clinch, but I think it's very important. So to get back to your question, Marcel, to kind of answer it a little bit more directly, yeah, I mean, I would watch Sugar Ray Robinson, Sugar Ray Leonard, Muhammad Ali, Jack Dempsey, even Driscoll. I would definitely watch like Roy Jones for sure, James Toney. I'm just giving you boxers. I'll give you some kickboxers soon, but I'm pretty well versed in the boxers. I would definitely, I mean, even some of the modern guys like Triple G, you have to watch Canelo Alvarez, Floyd Mayweather, Manny Pacquiao, Lomachenko. A lot of the guys you guys should be watching because they're just on another level. I mean, they're doing what we're talking about live against the best guys on the planet. I mean, why wouldn't you watch them? The old guys and the new guys alike. So for the kickboxing, of course, you can use the legs. There's fancy stuff, head kicks, spinning kicks, spinning elbows, you know, stuff that's crazy in the clinch, dunks and throws, and catching of the kicks. And we could do some of that too, but I think especially since the social distancing thing, show you some good old combinations, good old tactics that a lot of the kickboxers are using. And man, they're smashing guys. Like, if you look at MMA, so just like a fun fact before we go into hitting again. If you look at MMA, like, it started like this, right? The Gracies started the UFC, so they obviously plugged their guys. They didn't have a good boxer wrestler. They had guys that strike that didn't know what they were doing on the floor, and wrestlers that couldn't strike, so Poise came in and smashed everybody, and you know, jiu-jitsu started going everywhere, and jiu-jitsu guys started winning. Then the wrestlers, Matt Hughes, just bashes Hoyce Gracie. Wrestling starts taking over for 7, 8, 10 years, whatever it was. Now striking. Everybody's talking about striking. Striking's taking over. Because the strikers got smart. They started sprawling and brawling. Look at Israel Adesanya, championship kickboxer. Now he's in the top of the division. He's smashing everybody. Everybody's like, how does he do this? How does he do that? They call him the style bender, right? You know, and just a silver big-time kickboxer. It's like today's lesson is kind of like the difference between today and yesterday, which was the MMA guys. So today we're doing the boxers and the kickboxers, and like I said, we're gonna get into the kickboxers. Specialist versus generalist, right? So this is really important. You have stand-up striking, you have wrestling on the feet, and you have grappling on the floor, right? You have to know each section at least a little bit and not be totally lost. So like that's why even our grappling classes, like we're doing a lot of takedowns, takedown defense, wrestling. Then we're gonna hit a period where we're gonna do a lot of grappling, like guillotines, arm bars, triangles, omoplatas, and how to defend all that stuff, because you need to be able to in the position on the floor, and it's gonna cycle through the curriculum, right? Because you don't wanna have a big gaping hole. But most guys or gals, they're really good at one thing. Are you a striker? Are you more of a wrestler? Are you a great jiu-jitsu practitioner? We're more, we smash you on the feet, you don't take me down. If I want to take you down, I take you down. I bash you, and if I have to submit you, I will, but I don't want to be in that position. So that strategy is time-tested and proven. I mean, so many UFC guys are using it. Look at even the wrestlers, they're staying up and bashing people because wrestling somebody down is exhausting. Then beating them on the floor in position, then trying to submit them. What if I get tired and I get reversed? Like, you may not want to engage in that capacity all the time, but moving and hitting is a great idea. So the whole idea of, so let's get back to specialist versus generalist. See, the specialist, like let's say he's a specialist striker, I would suggest getting really, really good takedown defense and then having good jiu-jitsu or good grappling on the floor, whatever that means. There's other ways in jiu-jitsu, sometimes with leg lock buys, there's other things, right? But you gotta have one that you're really good at, or then the other two are like pretty good, right? But no gaping holes. Or you're all three. But if you're all three and you spend the same time, you're probably not so great at one thing, which means you're going to have a hard time finishing somebody. So if you're not that great, implicit is that you can't finish the person. So again, for the self-defense crowd and self-defense community, which most of us are, as we care about in many ways, is I don't want to be on my back playing jiu-jitsu, even though I hold rank in it and I like jiu-jitsu and I won a lot of tournaments and this, that, and the third. I'd rather be striking, wrestling, stuff in the takedown. And when I started wrestling, my grappling game really changed. That's why we do a lot of wrestling in here at Martial Arts Academy and some jiu-jitsu, but a lot of wrestling. It's good for self-defense. So I'm going to get into some of the kickboxing and I'm going to name the fighters for you now, but just keep in mind that, you know, you have to get, you don't want to be jumping around too much. You can't be just a generalist. You have to be a specialist and then work the other two, work the whole. So it's striking, grappling, standing, and then grappling on the floor. It's just basically striking and grappling, but it's, you know, the striking, the grappling, standing is different than grappling on the floor. It just is. So you need both. So without further ado, I mentioned, so Israel Adesanya is going to be the first guy that I talk about. And Israel is the 185 champion in the UFC, but he was a big-time world kickboxing champion. So his skills, he took the time to learn how to defensively wrestle, and now he's bashing guys on the feet. The longer you stand with this guy, it's just taking the time off. And then he's just obviously stopping the takedown, but he's also just using his distance really well. So if you're a longer-range fighter, whether you're tall or you just like fighting in the longer range, real simple tactic, you're fighting there, you're fighting there, just a post or a paw, right? So I'm here, I'm fighting, I post, I paw, and then I fire right to that low kick, right? So he's doing a classic kickboxing move, combo tactic, but he's just doing it really well, posting at the right time, on the right opponent, and then finishing up with a simple low kick, right? So he's over there, like, if you notice, a lot of these moves that the champions are using, they're nothing magical or mystical, they're just being done really, really well, right? So, you know, guys here, you're this way, you post, just like that. Post, just there, right? Just following up with that simple low kick, right? So, really cool, we were talking about it the other day in the shifting class, and we're gonna show you one that he's doing, Israel Adesanya. He's there, he's in southpaw, and then he's firing right away. So he's like, he's here, he's long, he's moving, he steps back, jab, cross, firing, we kick after. So he's simply here, jab, cross, this way, or jab, cross, firing, kicking. So he's simply shifting back, firing a jab across, low kick. And it's just a simple combo mixed in with a pretty advanced shift, a backward shift with the combo, pretty high level, pretty freaking cool, right? So, excuse me. Another just really, 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 when I say really cool kickboxer, if you ever look up Andy Sauer, he's an old K1 kickboxing champ. He would throw the classic Dutch combinations. So there's different kickboxers from different sides of the world. You have Dutch kickboxers that like more boxing, right? So Andy Sauer used to have this really cool combo. And all the Dutch guys do it, but he did it really well. Jab, slip, hook the body, chop the leg. So beautiful. So jab, slip, dig the body, step off as you chop the leg. So Andy Sauer, a lot of the Dutch kickboxers use this combo. I'll show from a different angle. So he would go jab, slip, dig, firing the low kick. So jab, slip, dig, firing that low kick. I'll show it on this side again. Jab, slip, dig, firing that low kick. And again, Andy Sauer, great, 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 great kickboxer from the Netherlands, super nasty, super vicious. Now, another Dutch kickboxer, Ramon Dekkers. Oh, he was like Mike Tyson with kicks and elbows. So he would do really cool stuff. Like he would go slip, body, uppercut, big hook down the middle. Just literally just as vicious as they came. Just slip, body, uppercut, bang, bang, just turning over nasty shots. So again, slip, body, uppercut, bang, just hooking right down the middle. Just rolling, body, body, leg kick, smashing the kick on this side, big hook, smashing, just like loading shots on guys, just hook, load, kick, no mercy for human life, basically. So Ramon Dekker is another Dutch guy that was really, really cool. So, interesting. You have two Muay Thai champions, Buakaw, Sanchai. Sanchai is considered the best Muay Thai champion of all time. And he's in a very bladed stance, he's in, he's out. He does really fancy moves like these cartwheel kicks, but he's doing like pendulum hook kicks, as well as like roundhouse kicks, question mark kicks, nasty front kicks. We'll explore a little bit on each one of their styles. And Buakaw is just the Terminator. He just walks, marches, knees, and he looks like an action figure. And he's like super famous in Thailand. Like everybody knows Buakaw. He's got like 150 fights, multiple time world champion. If you ask me, the best tool that he has is a tool that's both in Muay Thai and in Jeet Kune Do, which is the switch kick, the quick switch to the body. So he's left lead. Most people are left lead, and he throws it at the liver. So what's cool is we throw our power kick to the liver. He's throwing his slightly weaker and more telegraphed quick switch to the liver, but it's the lead leg, and it does the trick. So when I was a kid, Muay Thai started getting popular, so it's one of the first arts that I trained in. And a lot of the tools that you can know guys like the elbows, the knees, the clinch work, and of course the shin kicks, which you're going to see in a second. We not only borrow from Muay Thai, change a little bit, but it's kind of the same, especially the quick switch, when it's done right. So, I'm going to show it to you a little bag here. First of all, another thing about Buakaw is he does this so well and so fast, he does it as his first attack. Pop! Quick switch! Scores! So look, he's here, he's moving, he fires. Right? He's there and he fires. Like, he's there, he's moving, nonchalant. And he just almost lulls you to sleep with no energy, just almost like, it's almost like he's not fighting. He's just looking at the guy and he's just. And then he's just smashing your legs, smashing your liver. So, Buakaw, we can do a whole thing on Buakaw, but that quick switch is what you should be taking from Buakaw. Now, Sanchez, he's got more claim, he's fancier. And by the way, Buakaw's got nasty elbows, nasty dunks, nasty head kicks, nasty roundhouse kicks, almost nasty everything. He got beat by a couple of boxer, kickboxer guys, but guys are awesome, right? Sanchez much fancier. He's in like a GPD stance, he's moving in and out, he's firing his leg, he's jumping, he's dumping, he's doing all this crazy stuff. But what's cool is he does a basic pendulum kick. So, you know, Buakaw's big into the classic Thai kick. The best of all time is doing a pendulum kick. So the best of all time Muay Thai guy is doing a Jeet Kune Do move. That's pretty cool. Guys have open minds and they learn from different guys. I mean, I never wanted to be closed-minded, but I'm not doing that because it's Muay Thai, or I'm not doing that because it's boxing or whatever. I do it if it works, and I make a Jeet Kune Do, and it is what it is. That's the way they'll learn, right? That's what Jeet Kune Do is about. It's about adapting and getting better. So, he figured out from here, this kick, my toes hit, my shin hits now. So some people think that sliding kicks don't have power, they're just not turning their hip over and hitting with the shin. So, Sanchez out here, he's moving, up, 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 he's firing, right? Super cool. So, different guys, right? Different types of champions, different types of dudes, different types of fighters. Super nasty. All just super, super nasty and just obviously work. So for the kickboxers, Israel Adesanya, Andy Sauer, Ramon Dekkers. We were just talking about Sanchai and Buakaw, right? That was awesome, awesome. And my guess is that over the years, MMA guys, there's going to be more of these super high-level kickboxers that are going to come from, you know, Thailand and that side of the world, maybe some of the parts of Europe too, where they just come into MMA, they just are taking guys by storm. They just naturally get a good wrestling coach, good grappling coach, and they want to learn, you know? Just like the wrestlers came in and got good striking coaches, I think the opposite will happen. I think that some striking coaches, the grappling coach will take over with some strikers and they'll get good. It's the same thing like wrestlers. They always do good in your martial arts academy because they lead with their dominant foot forward, they're hard workers, they're strong, they hit hard. But anybody can get good at this. This is not like, you know, magic, mystical, whatever. It's just learning the moves and learning what to do them and being tough about it, you know? Question?
So Ramon is asking us, Tyson Fury, you have good footwork for a heavyweight.
I think Tyson Fury is awesome. I think he's got even better head movement. So Tyson Fury, like, if you look at the clips, he gets caught square on the ropes, but he's like rolling under these shots and just firing back, and then just back in the boxing stance. I mean, he put a beating on that guy. He put a beating on Deontay Wilder. That's a good fight to watch too, if you want to watch just a good old heavyweight beatdown. Tyson Fury beating up Deontay Wilder, like bleeding out of his ear, is nasty. So yeah, I mean, there's a lot of good boxers out there, there's a lot of good kickboxers, a lot of good wrestlers. Like, you know, even when you look at grappling, like, you gotta remember, like, the UFC guys are not the best grapplers on the planet. Like, Marcelo Garcia, who just has, like, a grappling gym in New York City, like, he's a jiu-jitsu guy, he would, like, manhandle Andrei Arlovsky. But he's, like, a hardcore jiu-jitsu guy, he's not there to, like, teach you how to fight. I'm gonna sit down and talk to you guys. He's not there to, like, teach you how to fight, like, MMA fight, he's there to teach you IBJJF tournament style jiu-jitsu at its best, you know? And you just gotta know what you're in for. It's like, even though we believe in street fighting, we believe in, you know, self-defense and learning the best ways to do everything. And that's why we really like our striking, we like for our grappling, a little bit more wrestling, a little bit of jiu-jitsu and stuff like that, but a lot of wrestling. And I just look at it as like study. You know, I threw out a lot of names today, a lot of names. We'll go back on the tape and go through the names and just look them up and look at the tactics that they're using, look how they're doing it. What stuff can you do? What stuff can't you do? Why? Does it fit in your structure? Does it not? And learn how to study. Because if you learn how to learn and you learn how to study, you're going to be ever evolving, ever growing as a human. If you don't know how to learn and you don't know how to study, what excuse do you have now? There's nothing going on. Everything's closed. Like, you know, if you're not going to learn now, when are you going to learn? When you're back at work, when you're back at school, when everything's closed. Well, I'm home with my kids. Yeah, I understand. My kids go to sleep, and you could study after. You know, I have a kid, I study, you know? My wife has a kid, she studies. You know, I think that everybody should study. And if you haven't, just do it now. Study your martial arts. Study your personal finance and your business skills. You know, study your art form. If you like playing music, study it. If you like boxing, study it. Like, jiu-jitsu, study it. You like doing whatever you like to do, study it. Because now is the time that you have. There's never going to be so much free time, I would guess, in the next 10, 20 years. You know? What's up?
Ramon is asking, what's the difference between a savate kick and a jiu-jitsu kick?
So the savate guys, some of it's exactly the same, some of it's slightly different. Let me explain, right? So a classic savat kick actually hits with, they were like these steel toe boots, but you can modify it and kick with like the ball of your foot. So instead of going shin across, you hit with the ball of your foot, bah. So first answer is there's no difference because we hit with the ball of our foot that way as well. Now, the savate guys do it with the toe because the way they have the foot, but we hit with the ball of the foot. So you can do both. It's not like they're different or the same. It's just that the savate guys do it with the toes and we do it with the ball of the foot. So you can set up any kick that you want that way. I hope that answers your question, Ramon. Any other questions? Because now it's question time. Keep them coming both on Instagram and on YouTube. I'll do my best to answer them. Like I said, I'm a big believer in using dead time. Like, even if you drive to work or you take the train, like, throw Tony Robbins in your ears. Listen to some good motivational stuff. Don't listen to all this negative news. It sucks. It sucks hearing it every single day. Every single day, okay, we know we're down till May 15th. Take a break from it for 5 days. build on yourself or just listen to it for an hour. Like when you let times like this make you become somebody you don't want to become, like a nasty person or a spiteful person or just a mischievous person or whatever, like it's a breaking character and stop. You know, like I heard somebody today in the street yelling at some lady, and I told the guys, like, stop, she's an old lady, let her go. Like, blah, 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 this, that, people get crazy. But bottom line is, what's up?
So Ramon is asking, what's your input on the Russian martial arts system?
Sistema? I don't like Sistema as much as I like Sambo. So there's another martial art called Russian Sambo. It's basically like, they do leg locks, they do some judo. It's like a combination. They box a little bit. It's like their version of MMA. It's like stand-up MMA without the ground. So they have their kimono, they have a headgear, they have gloves. I don't like that they have the kimono on, by the way. But they fight with the hands, and they throw each other, and they have a point system for all of it. So I like Sambo a little bit better. I think that some of the more mainstream arts are more prevalent though. Like again, if you look at grappling and you were gonna have like a wrestler, like that wrestled his or her whole life, but you got a wrestler and then you taught him submission defense and how to submit people and positional stuff on the ground, that person's gonna have an easy time. If you took somebody who never did anything physical, never played football, basketball, baseball, you try to teach them how to wrestle, it might be a little hard in their 30s, but could happen. Could definitely happen. It's just gonna be a little harder, right? And it's like, it depends on the person too, right? Like some people are more built for wrestling, some people are more built for striking. Some wrestlers never strike. And just because you wrestle doesn't mean you can fight. Like there's a lot of guys that they wrestled their whole life, but they've never had punches thrown at them. Ever, ever, ever. And they've never been submitted before. They don't even know what the submissions are. Or they've been submitted and they have no idea what's going on. Guy's not that dangerous then, because he's wrestling's a transition. It's I take you down to control you, to then bash you or to submit you. But if you can't control me, if you can take me down when you can't control me, or if you can't take me down, you're worse. But even if you can take me down, you can't control me. I'm wrapping you up and armbarring you and guillotining you and sweeping you because you don't know what you're doing. But if you could strike and you could stop somebody's takedown, you don't have to worry about it. If someone takes you down your hip and you're wizarding and getting back up because you have good wrestling, you don't have to worry about it as much. And then you learn how to fight off your back a little bit. But you want to not be on your back. I mean, I haven't seen too many guys winning off their back lately in the UFC. Not too many. Jiu-Jitsu guys say whatever they want. And I'm a Jiu-Jitsu guy. I love Jiu-Jitsu. But at the end of the day, like, there's not anybody winning off their back. Like, they're not pulling guard and winning anymore. Like, that's just not happening. So get that out of your head if you think you're going to be some whatever. It's going to take you 10 years to do that. Why not just stand and bang, or take the guy down and be on top, and then work your submissions and your more dominant positions from the top position. Even a jiu-jitsu guy should want to be on top. So, you know, if there's more questions, again, bring them in. But, you know, things are evolving. Things are getting more scientific, even like strength and conditioning stuff. You know, I've said it to some of the students, and my dad and I have talked probably, I mean, what's really going to change in the curriculum as we open, as things that, you know, we're going to obviously clean the schools top to bottom, basically bleach everything from the ceiling to the floors multiple times at all four locations. But, you know, Jeet Kune Do is our core. It's great footwork, great striking, good trapping, wrestling, good weapon. Then we're also going to have our grappling and our wrestling classes, but also a little bit of wrestling in the classes, not too much, but separate wrestling classes. Brooklyn and Astoria already have it. Little Neck and Glencoe will soon enough, I'm sure. We're going to be having some like strength and conditioning, some fitness classes. So you're getting your striking, you're getting your grappling, you're getting your strength and conditioning all under one roof. And that's what I always wanted to do for the students. It's logistically possible now on all four locations, so it's going to be happening. It's already happening in Astoria and Williamsburg. It'll happen in Glen Cove and Little Neck as well. And remember, you can train any one of the four schools when you're a member. So whatever you guys want. What's up?
So Ramon is asking, referring to a session in this week prior, he's asking about the hand positioning. When is it wide? When you're in medium range or close range?
Oh, it can be either one. Like the hands up like this is close range, this is long range, this is medium range, this is longer range, this is medium range. The hand position is determined by the distance, but also what are you seeing in front of your opponent? Like, are you thinking that I can hit him with these long, kind of wide chipping shots? Are you trying to be super technical and super tight?
it's all what you're seeing and what you're reading live. Like, the hard thing about being an instructor is I can tell you what are good habits. Like, you know, this is where like fighting instincts and just who the person is mentally comes into play. But like, I can say you keep your chin down, pick your hands up, move around, throw good combinations, move your feet, move your head, stuff the takedown, take the dude down, make him pay. If he gets back up, take him down again, do this, do that. But if you can't pull it off, you can't pull it off. That's one thing. But sometimes it's easier said than done. It's easier for me to say it than for you to do it, number one. Okay, that's one thing. But, you know, sometimes you gotta read the situation. Like, and that's what's hard. Like, I can tell you all the right stuff, but I don't know exactly what this person's gonna do to you at the exact time. I'm not gonna be there when the person fights with you. It's not a sanctioned fight on you if it's self-defense. And then you have to think on the fly. But when you're here with me, I'm trying to coach you and trying to give you good habits along the way. We're trying to build you and let you be ready to go out on your own a little bit. We build you to go out on your own a little bit. That's the way it works. So I hope that answers the question. Any other questions, Tom?
No, just from my comment, Ted Wong, hand position.
Oh, he's the man. Super Ted is Super Ted. I love that man. You know, I love Super Ted. I love Super Chris. I obviously love my father, Super Dino. I'm blessed, man. Bottom line is I'm blessed. I'm blessed to be a part of the Jigingo family. I'm blessed to have been around it from a young age. And I'll tell you, and this is going to sound maybe a little snug, a little cocky or whatever, but I never realized how cool and special Jigingo was until I saw the other martial arts. Like, you know, because I realized that Jigingo had things that other martial arts didn't have, but I also knew about the things that it did have. And the way it was put together, I was like, oh, well, maybe boxing. And I was looking at boxing, like, man, they're gonna let their legs chopped off and they're gonna take it down. Look, they're wrestling, as well, they get submitted when they do it the floor, they might get beat up on the feet. All these partial truths, jiu-jitsu, there's not so many takedowns and there's no striking, right? All these partial truths, and jiu-jitsu should be free and develop every aspect of your game, and research and develop and be an individual, and you're more important than the style, the system, or be part of a community that is open-minded and not closed-minded. And just like all the things that we stand for. And I said, wow, you know, I was like 25, and I'm 31 now, I was like 24, 25. I said, wow, I'm so lucky. So lucky. I started teaching full-time. I started teaching when I was, you know, 18, 19, but I started teaching full-time when I was 22, 23 years old. And I'm 31, I've been doing it for 8 years, and it's the best thing that ever happened to me. It was the best thing that, you know, I happen to believe in God. If you do, great. If not, it's fine. But God gave me, you know, the ability to communicate and show some of my skills, but also try to relay some of those skills to other people. And, you know, I'm happy that I can do this for a living, even though we're far away from each other now. I do feel that, you know, in May, sometime we'll be open, and everybody will be back, we'll have a good time, and hopefully everybody will be back. And for those of you that are worried, you can take a little extra time, that's fine. But, you know, study, you know, just study and become a better person. You know, I'm at the hour mark, I might go a little bit over if you guys have more questions, but at the end of the day, just let the art be a good part of you. And like I was saying before, I feel so lucky that I'm part of the Jigingo family, Jigingo community. I was exposed to Ted Wong, who did the most lessons one-on-one with Bruce. He's one of my instructors. Super Chris Kent's another one of my instructors. My father, Super Dean, is another one of my instructors. I have a purple belt in jiu-jitsu, I wrestled, I did a lot of weapon work. So I've done a lot of different martial arts, I boxed, I did Muay Thai. But Jigingo was the best, because it taught me footwork and range, and had to be slippery, and just how to mix it together with the takedowns and the defense, and put the weapon in there too, and it's just so awesome. And when I think about it, again, I'm just lucky. I'm lucky, there's no other way to say it.
So Ramon is asking if there was one question you could ask Bruce Lee or Ted Wong, what would it be?
I'd ask Bruce what he wanted for Jigingo. I'd ask, like, I mean, obviously, like, assuming, like, I could bring him back to life and he could see today, be like, what do you think? What do you want? You know, do you want it to continue the way it is? You know, am I doing a good job? You know, just stuff like that. I look for his guidance. I mean, you know, the student doesn't tell the teacher. The student asks the teacher. You know, I'd ask him to show me the best stuff that he could. I'd show him what I've been working on and see if it's, you you know, up to his standards, of course, but I believe it would be, I believe the technique would be, I'm sure he'd have his critiques, but I got to ask Stephen Ted along a lot of questions. And I asked him why footwork. I said, you know, of all the things, why not be just a master kicker or a master puncher? A master jiu-jitsu man or whatever. And so Instagram shut off, I just came back on. So I asked Super Ted, you know, why footwork? Why not be a master puncher, a master kicker, master grappler, jiu-jitsu man, whatever? And he said something interesting to me. He goes, well, we're master strikers and, you know, we need to grapple, but footwork is a threat. I said, what do you mean footwork is a threat? And well, he goes, think about it simply. He goes, you're far away, you want to get close, footwork gets you there. You're close, you want to get far, footwork gets you there. You want to get to that angle, footwork gets you there. You're in trouble, footwork gets you out. You see an opportunity, footwork darts you in. And he goes, if your footwork is perfect, you never get hit, you'd always be in a position to hit again, and you'd always be damaged. I said, wow, that's so smart. And his footwork was second to none. And you know, it's interesting because knowing Sifu Ted personally, and like talking to him, not just like talking to him in a room full of people, everybody's watching him, and you know, he's gotta be a little politically correct, right? Just talking to him, you know, personally, and just like eating a slice of pizza in New York, I would say, like, you know, what do you think? He goes, I think you guys are doing a good job. Like, you just say things like that. He's like, I think Super Chris Kent is top tier. I think your dad is top tier. You know, and he's like, he was happy. He was happy with the way things were going in terms of the content. He wasn't happy with some of the things that other people were doing or whatever, but it's fun. And Sifu Chris Kennedy, he's a guy's an encyclopedia, man. Like, you talk to Sifu Chris, and he's just like casually talking about Jeet Kune Do days, like old school stuff with Daniel Sano, which is cool, but just the knowledge he knows about fencing, old school boxing, taekwondo, judo, leverage in the body, kinesiology. You're just like, this guy's an encyclopedia. It's crazy. Like, I'll probably never know the amount of stuff that this guy knows. And he praises his big time too, and I appreciate it, but you know, we owe a lot to Sifu Chris. You know, my dad, for just dedicating his career and his life to this, and he was a successful restauranteur, you know, back in the day, before it was cool and when it was super profitable, and he didn't like it. He wanted to do martial arts, he took over the school, and that was that. You know, it's like, I probably wouldn't be in the martial art business if it wasn't for him. I probably wouldn't be in the martial art game and just training and all that stuff and teaching if it wasn't for him. So, look, I mean, like I said, if you guys are still here, thank you for listening. Thank you for hanging out. We're gonna close up. I had such a good time with you guys today. I hope that you guys have a good time tomorrow. I got a treat for you guys tomorrow. So tomorrow's Friday, and obviously next day Saturday. Sifu Teddy is gonna be back with Sifu Temi, so they're gonna share the frame. I will be here for 2 days, and I'll be back on Monday. I'm gonna spend some time with the missus and the baby. But I hope everybody has a good time. Sifu Teddy, just turn them off. Thank you guys for listening. Thank you guys for watching. And you guys are amazing. Thank you so much.